You may think of a load balancer as the traffic cop sitting in front of your servers and routing client requests across all servers. This helps in servers to increase its capacity and serve more concurrent users. However, a well-designed load balancer must strive to distribute load evenly across the servers, maximizing server throughput and minimizing latency. In this short video, I'll simplify the basics of load balancer with some practical examples for beginners and move to some advanced concepts. In a simple client-server system, a client sends requests to the server performs a business logic, it may interact with other services or fetch data from database and returns the response back to the client. Imagine this system becoming bigger, that is, instead of one client, many clients are now sending requests to the server. In fact, each client can issue multiple requests to the server. A single server in this case has limited resources and limited throughput to accommodate requests from all the clients in a given amount of time, which may cause the server to overload and may cause slowness or failure to process requests. To handle this, we typically scale our system, and there are two ways of doing this, vertical scaling and horizontal scaling. Vertical scaling is basically increasing the power of the server, but this being a single server, the increase in resources is limited, which is why horizontal scaling is the popular option, where we add more machines or servers to the system. So now, if we have three servers instead of one, we can handle a lot more requests from our clients. Assuming that the servers have similar power, this new setup can now handle three times the load of the previous setup. We, however, must ensure that requests are being processed by the server in a balanced way. For example, here client C1 sends requests to server S1, C2 sends requests to S2, and C3 to S3. A load balancer helps the client to direct the request to the server. Load balancer is basically another server that sits between clients and servers, and its job is to redirect clients' requests to servers to balance workloads and maintain even distribution so that none of the servers are overloaded. So with the load balancer in the mix, our clients would now issue requests to the load balancer, and the load balancer will redirect the request in balanced way to the server. As you are horizontally scaling your system by adding servers, the load balancer will make use of new resources, which will help in improving the overall throughput of the system and reduce latency. Load balancers work on the behalf of the clients or servers, and so they can be also termed as reverse proxy. Load balancer is not limited to just client and servers. You might also have a load balancer between your server and database, or between your server and other servers, or even at the DNS layer of a website. So when you type google.com on your browser, a DNS query is made to get the IP address of the server to process your request. Google has many servers, and a DNS load balancer will return the IP address in a load balanced way. For example, in this Windows machine, I have two command prompt or terminals open. Think of them as clients. I'm going to use nslookup, which is a command line tool for querying DNS, to obtain IP address. When I issue the command nslookup google.com, it gives me the IP address of google.com. So on my left terminal window, nslookups give me this IP address. On my right, it gives me this IP address. Notice it returns different IP addresses, and if I do curl on them, both of them return HTML pages from Google. This is happening due to a DNS load balancer between the client, in this case my terminal windows, and Google servers. Coming back to a load balancer can be a hardware or a software load balancer. With the hardware load balancer, you are limited and they can be expensive. Software load balancers, however, are cheap and can be highly customizable. When you add or remove a server, it needs to register or deregister from the load balancer so that the load balancer can start redirecting requests to the server. Now, in order to distribute load evenly to the servers and based on certain scenarios, there are many ways a load balancer does this, also known as server selection strategy. The simplest way is pure random selection of server, but this can still result in specific server being overloaded. A popular way load balancer do server selection is round robin, where it goes through all the servers in a loop, guaranteeing even distribution of load across servers. A slightly customized version of round robin is weighted round robin, where you still follow the order, but you give weight to servers. So if you give more weight to a second server, it will redirect more additional requests before going to server 3. This is usually done when one server is more powerful. In this case, server 2 is more powerful, so we gave it more weight. Another way of load balancing is based on the traffic being served by the server. Basically, your load balancer pings your server to check its health, and based upon how fast the server is responding, how much server resources are occupied, it decides to direct traffic or not. You can also have an IP-based server selection strategy, where it gets requests from clients and hashes the IP address so that the specific server is serving a specific client or set of clients. This is especially useful when your server is caching. So if client 1 sends a request, it always goes to server 1. So when the request comes for the first time, the server computes the request and puts that in its cache. When the same request comes again, the server doesn't need to process it. It will simply return the response from its cache. Depending upon the situation, you might also design a system where you end up having multiple load balancers and with different flavors of server selection strategy. We'll talk more about load balancer in our future videos of our system design series.